Namaste and welcome to this exciting episode of Sattology, debunking mythology. Sattology means science of truth, the study of truth. Opposite of that is mythology, which means science or study of fake lie or imagination. Do join our literature festival in August in San Diego. And also do join our courses. Our courses have been extremely popular, so much so that we don't have trainers to teach them right now. Good problem to have and very bad outcome for us. So thank you for all your love and support. Aap sabka bahut sneh ka, main bahut aabhari hu sabke sneh ka aur aapke samarthan ka bhi. Aur main chahta hu ki aap hamara sare shows dekhiye, subscribe kariye, shorts banaiye, apne channels pe chalaiye sab shorts, and we'll be very grateful to all of you. Aaj hamare sath jude hain my favorite Major General Harsh Kakar, aur main unse thoda deep dive karunga hum sabke benefit ke liye, thoda tough question bhi puchunga to understand what is actually going on. Aur kyunki hum duniya bhar ka opinion dete hain analyst log, main analyst nahi hu, I'm a sanatan dharm ka, we can say promoter, pracharak, promoter bhi nahi hu, English word promoter ka meaning kuch aur hota hai, but I'm a servant, small student and servant. और मैं उनसे घुसूंगा कि आप बताइए कि ये जो इंडियन आर्मी के डिसीजंस सोशल मीडिया पे तो नहीं बनते हैं कि इंडियन आर्मी क्या खरीदना चाहती है क्या नहीं खरीदना चाहती है, दैट दे हैव टू डिसाइड. वी यू एंड मी आर नोबडीज हियर एंड बीइंग एन अमेरिकन सिटीजन आई हैव अ थर्ड पार्टी व्यू. तो विदाउट डिले लेट अस वेलकम मेजर जनरल रिटायर्ड हर्ष कक्कर. नमस्ते, वेलकम टू द शो सर. कई बात तो मैंने एडमिट कर दिया अपने मोनोलॉग में कि हम डिसाइड, मैं डिसाइड नहीं करने वाला हूं, जस्ट लाइक वी हैव नो से इन अमेरिकन आर्मी परचेजेस, वी हैव नो से इन इंडियन आर्मी परचेजेस आल्सो, कि वो क्या खरीदते हैं क्या नहीं खरीदते हैं, बिकॉज एवरी आर्मी डिसाइड्स फॉर इटसेल्फ. आप मुझे बताइए कि ये जो आज जो चाइना के ऊपर चल रहा है, एक और मैं न्यूज, मैं काफी न्यूज पढ़ रहा हूँ, जैसे चाइना में चाइनीज फोर्सेज ने बॉर्डर में बंकर्स बना दिए, और तो पहले तो इस इशू पे हम लोग चलते हैं, देन यू कैन वी कैन मूव ऑन समथिंग एल्स प्लीज.
सी, जहां तक सवाल है, एवरी कंट्री, इनफैक्ट इंडिया ऑन बोथ इट्स बॉर्डर्स, यू कीप इंप्रूविंग योर पोटेंशियल. फॉर अ वेरी लॉन्ग टाइम चाइना हैड नो डिफेंसेस ऑन द बॉर्डर बिकॉज इट डिड नॉट एक्सपेक्ट इंडिया टू गो ऑन द ऑफेंसिव. इंडिया हैड अ डिफेंसिव फिलोसफी. So we were the ones that were constructing bunkers and we were preparing for a defensive battle. The fact is, the scenario is reversing. India has earmarked forces for an offensive into China, into Tibet. Let me use the right word. It is not China. It is Tibet. In case operations do take place. The Chinese, which had never bothered for such a thing, are now concerned. That's number one. Number two, what they are constructing are also dual purpose, like we have done. These are habitat bunkers. They are modified for the weather conditions, for the terrain. Aur dusra hai, ye defensive bhi hai. इनका प्लानिंग इज पार्ट ऑफ अ डिफेंसिव लेआउट कि भाई हाउ आर वी एबल टू हॉल्ट द ऑफेंसिव. साथ साथ चाइना इज बिल्डिंग एयरफील्ड्स क्लोज टू द बॉर्डर, हमारे पास भी है. सो देर इज अ रेगुलर पीरियड ऑफ अपडेटिंग ऑफ योर डिफेंसिव एंड योर एम्प्लॉयमेंट स्ट्रक्चर. अर्लियर ये था दैट यू नेवर हैड द फैसिलिटीज, येट देर इज अ मेजर डिसएडवांटेज. हमारा जो भी हमको चाहिए इज अवेलेबल जस्ट बिहाइंड. आ हिंडरलैंड इज क्लोज. चाइना के लिए एवरीथिंग नीडेड फॉर कंस्ट्रक्शन या इनको जो भी मेंटेनेंस के लिए चाहिए कम्स फ्रॉम द मेनलैंड. दे हैव टू केटर फॉर स्टोरिंग दैट ऑल्सो. सो देर आर मल्टीपल रिक्वायरमेंट्स. इट इज नथिंग विच इज रियली अ सॉर्ट ऑफ कॉज फॉर कंसर्न. द फोर्सेज आर प्रिपेयर्ड ऑन बोथ साइड्स. And after ये जो दो तीन incident हुए हैं, the last being in Yangtze in December 2022, the border has been generally stable. And that is how the scenario is and will remain. Ye jo aapko reports mil rahe aur incidents mil rahe, these are not something that is of a major consequence.
Can be just a media play also. We don't know what is happening.
Media is reporting. A more report or assessment of the report are two different things.
That's right. That's right. Very well put. Very good. Coming to America's assessment, and I'm talking to American military analysts, talking to them. I spoke to Douglas McGregor today, or मैंने पूछा उनको कि how do you view Indian military? उन्होंने बोला था कि it's not very important for us. It's a regional force and nothing to do with America. ये उनका reply था, बड़ा honest reply है मुझे लगा. So American military planners ka viewpoint is not important to the Indian military in many case. We are far apart. But at the same time, they almost seem to brush aside, which is a very good thing. Okay, which is, this is what Chanakya also says, we should hide over. What do you see that these American military planners think of Indian military as?
See, firstly, you have to understand, India has no territorial ambition. Secondly, India is not a military ally of the US. Thirdly, the armed forces of India are for the defense of India, not for anything outside. Right? Now, as far as the US is concerned, there are a few facts that they are very clear about. One, India is capable of handling its own defense. It does not need any assistance. Yes, what it does need are inputs in terms of availability of satellite and the rest, which at times may not be possible without. Secondly, India as an ally or India in the region ensures stability. India is a net security provider. The US is aware, Europe is aware. No country can operate in the Indian Ocean region without India's support, backing, and India as an ally. If you have to operate in the IOR, you have to have a link with India, which is why India and the US have signed multiple agreements. The Indian armed forces will never fight under the US flag. NATO will, but India will. We are very clear. If we have to fight under anyone, it will be under the UN flag. So therefore, us getting involved in operations with the US or alongside the US is not going to happen. However, the US needs India, especially when it comes to counterbalancing China. A strong India is a major counterbalance. India dominates the Indian Ocean. For the Chinese Navy to come and operate in the Indian Ocean, they are moving 3,000 kilometers. Koi Navy 3,000 kilometers from its base cannot operate in comfort. The US will operate from Diego Garcia, it will operate from its base in Okinawa, or it will operate from its base in Philippines. It needs a base to operate. The Indian Navy in the Indian Ocean region is in its own backyard. There is a world of a difference. So therefore, the relationship between India and the US is for India to provide security in the subcontinent, in the Indian Ocean, and they are aware that India is not going to fight alongside the US, and we don't expect the US to come and fight alongside the Indian forces against the Chinese. We are capable of handling it, whether Chinese or Pakistan or both sides. So therefore, the relationship is that you need to operate together, because you're going to operate in conjunction, not alongside. Bahut farak hai.
बहुत फर्क है, बहुत फर्क है.
एंड वी आर गोइंग टू इंश्योर दैट द आयोवा इज डोमिनेटेड बाय अस एंड वी हैव द पावर एंड द मिलिट्री कैपेबिलिटी टू. So therefore, the relationship between India and the US is different. Now, the US does maximum military exercises with India because it's learning a lot. And the cohesiveness of the two is to operate in conjunction, not jointly, not together. It wants India to hold this area, to dominate the Iowa, and that India will do.
Very well clarified, very well put it. One question comes in about the India's current let me check the sound quality, because everyone tells me my sound quality. Let me check my sound quality here. Yours is very good. So, with the Russian visit of Indian Prime Minister, when he is visiting Russia, Navy deals were announced, two frigate deals were announced, and other things were announced in the defense sector. And suddenly, the India-China equation also comes in, because most of the analysts report that Russia is in China's grip. I don't think so. Because Russians have been nobody's grip since the history, actually, we can say. And economically, people say that, and I don't believe in that, actually. Because Russia is a very self-respecting government, orthodoxy, I would say. So, how do you see the Indian military posture with the China getting influenced by India's relationships with Russia?
See, firstly, there is no doubt that as far as Russia-China relations are concerned, they've undergone a change, especially since the Ukraine war. China is now the stronger of the two partners. Russia is a junior partner, because you could notice the difference in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization summit, which was trying to push the Chinese agenda. And there is a tussle between Russia and China as to who's going to dominate the Central Asian region, which is with Russia as far as the military alliance is concerned, but economically they're all linked to China through the BRI. Now, as far as India is concerned, India is diversifying its military equipment, but it takes a long time for the military equipment, once inducted, to remain into service. We still have about 60% of our equipment is Russian origin, for which we need spares. We regularly need spares, which is what is the main issue of contention. Now, in the current meet between PM Modi and President Putin, the agreement that came through is Russia is going to establish joint companies in India to manufacture spares for the equipment that India uses. And not only India, there are other nations for which India and Russia could export. The BrahMos missile is a clear case of India-Russia collaboration. As far as new equipment is concerned, we are not looking at it from any country. It is, once the deal is signed, it will be made in India. Until you manufacture in India, we're not interested. The latest aircraft deal that we're looking at for the future, we're looking for 125 aircraft, and we said, unless you're willing to manufacture in India, don't even bid. As far as the ships are concerned, earlier they were made in Russia, now they're all going to be made in India in collaboration. Similar with submarines. Artillery guns were Russian. Today, they're not. They're all made in India. Whatever limited imports have come from US, that's where it is. So, to a large extent, it is going to be made in India. So, what we need from Russia are spares, and that is exactly what Putin promised, that we will set up the industries joint in India, joint industries in India. So, not only will India use, it will be exported. And it's not with Russia alone. It is with any country that we are now signing a deal, it is going to be manufactured in India with transfer of technology.
Actually, you are giving me such deep insights and very clarity, with all clarity, that now the things make it happier for me, as well as because phir bhi dil hai Hindustani, like that, you know, our hearts beat for India. And so one, I was showing a map how the US forces have surrounded China on the, from the ancient maps of India, I can say Malaya Sagar. At South China Sea, they call it Malaya Sagar. So ancient Indian territory, Cholas ruled that seas many years, and many Indian ancient seafarers to the east also ruled that seas. My question is, Indian Navy is very well poised in that region also. They're traveling in that region. Won't it help that India extends its reach towards that region to also counter or proactive take part in South China Sea or Malaya Sagar? What is your opinion on that?
See, as far as the Indian Navy is concerned, we conduct exercises with nations in the region. We've done it with Philippines. We do it with Indonesia. We do it with Malaysia, with Singapore, with Vietnam. So we are regularly conducting exercises. We are there. Our presence is there. And we do the exercises in the South China Sea, which is what China claims. But at the same time, that is not an area for us to operate. For the Chinese, if they come to the Indian Ocean region, it is 3,000 kilometers. For the Indian Navy to go there, it's the same distance. And that is not our area of interest. We need to control the Malacca Straits. We need to control the IOR. And our region of interest is from the Cape of Good Hope to the Malacca Straits. And that is the region we want to dominate. We don't want to dominate South China Sea. It's of no interest to us. So where we want to be building capabilities to deal with that.
Now, coming to very well put it, because it's clear on many viewers' point in many channels is being reported why, and you answered this question today. Now, in the, when you look at the Middle East, Iran and all these countries, new governments coming up, Israel, the war is happening. And how do you see the situation, that situation spiraling into something bigger? And all the European and American focuses over there for the various trade, and I think it's going to reduce further because their capability is significantly, they don't have the money to operate those areas. So how do you see India will step in to fill that lacune?
Emptiness. See, India has always been talking of peace. India does not believe in supporting any particular side. At the same time, we are against terrorism. So we backed Israel on the terrorist strike. We backed Israel when it retaliated. But we are not supporting Israel because of the humanitarian situation in Gaza. We are talking of peace. As far as the rest of West Asia is concerned, whether it is Iran, Saudi Arabia, any of the countries, India's relationship is excellent with each one of them. For us, it is of no concern. We've got our trade with Iran. In fact, we're using the Chabahar port. And we are the ones who are moving, in fact, the latest shipment of coal, which came from Russia, came by the North-South corridor to Iran and from Iran to India by ship. It came by rail till Iran and then by ship. So our relationship with all nations in the area are very strong. The fact is, we do not want an escalation where the world gets affected, where innocents are affected, and where the situation gets out, which is why PM Modi, wherever he talks of dialogue, he talks of peace, he talks of avoiding casualties, and he talks of adhering to the UN.
I'm showing a beautiful sight of the Indian tank and Zorawar. Beautiful tank. And done in a record manner and looks like a very high quality product coming out of L&T factory. And very unique design though, because both sides are additional protection to, I don't know what is that meant for, maybe ballast tanks or anything. So how do you see that the Atmanirbhar Bharat, which is there, and which is also an envy for the West, actually. People may, should not ever misunderstand that the West is supporting India's Atmanirbharta. West is very envious of the Atmanirbharta because they don't want anyone to become self-reliant. So how do you see this remarkable achievement? I wouldn't say achievement because this capability we have. I mean, according to me, given what I see the engineers, my own colleagues, we can build anything in India if you want to, including a next Facebook and next Twitter and anything else. But somehow the policies don't favor that. But now with this startup ecosystem and also the Indian private companies picking up like L&T and DRDO collaboration and the drones, how do you see the future of the Atmanirbhar Bharat in AI, in drones, in sea-based drones, in sky-based, higher flying drones acting as satellites? So how do you see that?
See, today, if any nation is to become a power, a superpower or a global power, it cannot depend on imports for its military. It has to be largely self-reliant. Largely. I'm not saying 100% self-reliant, nobody is. Even as far as the US is concerned, for its aircraft, parts come from all over. They're got together, largely manufactured within the US. So what you need to be able to do is to do a major part of your production yourself. Now, in operations, there are times when the countries that give you the products, they have restrictions on the manner in which it can be employed. So therefore, you have to prevent that, and for that you have to be Atmanirbhar. In the last 10 years, the defense industry has grown. Today, in fact, the shares of the defense industry are moving as fast as blue chips. Today, everyone is advised, you want to invest in the share market, go for the defense industry. Recently, there was a statement, I think it was celebrated also by the defense minister, where we crossed 17% increase in defense production over the last year. So that has been the sort of output that you're getting in the defense industry. The exports are increasing of Indian domestic products. And today we're making certain that if we want to buy anything, you will set up manufacturing in India. So you are going to become a major global manufacturing hub for defense products, which is going to be very ideal because no sanctions are then going to work on India in case it employs these products. A simple aspect was, if Pakistan is to employ F-16, it cannot employ them on the Indian front, they are monitored 24/7. We faced the same problem in operations earlier, but now we don't, because we are manufacturing it ourselves. And that is something that we are doing very well. And I think it's only going to grow. If you look at the number of deals that have been signed in the UP defense corridor, it is massive. And defense industries are coming in all across in the defense corridors which have been established. And that's going to be a major boon in the years ahead.
You know, I was showing a picture of a stealth paint which India mastered. And the West American companies mocked India and they mastered it, the stealth paint, which is better than even F-35 paint for radar absorbent material. I was showing that picture just now. So very significant strides. Now coming back to the China question and the Western media and the Western strategic so-called analysts have been projecting India as a bulwark against China. And you can clarify in the beginning also, India will not act against anybody else's provocation ever. India will act on its own choice when they want to. How do you see that propaganda by the Western media and the analysts sitting in India who try to sell American products to India and also try to create this false image of India-China conflict. Conflict is real, I totally agree. India is doing everything possible on the ground. But still, projecting to force the two countries to war will work on the Indian defense planners. What do you say?
See, I think the assessment is a bit wrong because very recently the US released its assessment of future conflicts. It covered a whole lot of areas. There was barely a mention of a very small paragraph on Indochina. So it is not that even the US is emphasizing, but there is a very light mention. It covered Taiwan, it covered Ukraine, Russia, it covered Israel, Gaza, and it covered also with Hezbollah and the works. It covered a large area of conflicts, but there was barely a mention of India-China because the scenario was changing. When you know your adversary is capable, when you know your adversary has a similar power, and he's focused in an area, nobody wants to start. So the intent on both sides is to avoid conflict, but at the same time, we and the Chinese have a difference in understanding. The Chinese want to move ahead with bilateral ties with the current LAC deployment. India is insisting that unless we go back to April 2020 positions, bilateral ties will not be. So those are the dialogues that are on, but otherwise the LAC is stable.
These are the pictures of the RIMPAC happening in Hawaii. And these are the pictures which shows the Indian Marcos with the American SEALs. Together, they're practicing or showing off their moves. The RIMPAC is a major exercise, you know that, in the US, and very few countries are invited, which is considered allies of United States. India is not an ally. India is called a strategic partner in the State Department. But India was invited. Why India is invited despite not being an ally? What do you think?
See, the point is, you know the capabilities of Indian forces. That's number one. Secondly, you're not going to operate together, but there's a lot to learn from one another. You need to have commonality in communications. After all, if it's something in the Indian Ocean region, and it's not only operations. These forces also help out in disaster relief. They operate together in those scenarios. Everything is not just linked to operations. In fact, the Quad began its exercises on disaster relief. And that is something which is going to continue. So no matter which way you look at it, the disaster relief aspect of Indo-US relations operating jointly will definitely remain. Secondly, you've got piracy going on. You've got these things where the forces may need to operate side by side. India has operated with the US in the Red Sea as far as the Houthis and the rest are and the pirates are concerned. So there is a lot. Everything doesn't specifically need to be operationalized.
Coming to back to the India-China border, what do you think is the weak points of Indian military as far as the borders are concerned?
Look, we had a weak point in terms of infrastructure development, which we are catching up with now. As far as the force structures are concerned, we are confident. In fact, our defensive layout is far more stronger than the Chinese because we've been doing it for decades. As far as weaponry is concerned, we are almost now running equal. So there has been a lot of change. And this and the current government over the last 10 years with the infrastructure improvement, they're making the borders far more faster and accessible than anything else. Earlier, what took you patrols to reach, today you're driving up. So a lot of things have changed. And I think we're moving up to a very comfortable state as it is in dealing with the Chinese.
Yeah, I think so. I can see that. Other than Indian opposition, nobody makes a noise.
That is political. I mean, that is best left aside.
True, very true. coming to the eastern side of coming to Manipur and Kuki areas, which I will admit to viewers, I don't understand. And I don't understand for the simple reason because Presbyterian Episcopal Church of US is very heavily involved in conversion in those areas. That I know. And that's why the US State Department wanted to protect Christians in that state, which was a direct interference from the US State Department. Not from the US State Department, but the American media. So how do you see the situation in that part of the region? Because it is a direct involvement of American churches over there, plus the local environment.
See, these are things that remain. I mean, there are differences between communities, between tribes. And these are nothing new. They've been historical. They've been the hill areas where you've been using it to grow drugs, to grow basically drugs and move it from there, which the state has tried to curtail. And that has been a major source of income for the locals. You have an open border with Myanmar because the tribes were distributed on both sides of the border. These are issues which have been there for a long time. The ruling group largely consisted of the plains. The hills felt they were ignored, those who were living in the hills and towards the Myanmar side. So these are clashes that have taken place. There is a lot of effort that's going on to cool it down. Interference, let's look at it very clearly. Today, Canada accuses India of interference in its elections. The Khalistanis tried to interfere in the Indian elections. No matter who comes in, will say that the Indian diaspora was being influenced by India in the US elections or in the Canadian elections when they come up. So these are things that remain. And there will always be an attempt to protect turfs, to protect the influence, to influence in those regions. The main aim is to try and bridge the gap between communities, between tribes, to try and get an understanding between them, to try and either separate them initially. So that those are processes that are moving. It's not a single agency that can bring it about. You need to have the security forces working alongside the government to try and resolve the issue. And this is a slow process. It's taking time. You find a lot of change has come in over the months. The incidents which were there initially have reduced drastically. So it's going to take its time. It's going to cool down.
I mean, just like India has, like you correctly said, tribes have perceptions and other things. US has a bigger fault line. There are 11 million Americans who are Native Americans who don't recognize the federal government, who don't recognize American Constitution. They don't recognize, they always say that they never got independence. And America is an illegal nation on their soil. They say it openly and they've been saying it for years. I mean, this is an open fault line, which I actually came to understand when I wrote the book Gold, Glory and God. And I could not understand why it became an overnight bestseller. And I'm not promoting the book, but I don't feel shy of telling about the book. I was shocked the reception it got in the US and Mexico and no other land, no other region. It didn't get much reception in Canada, UK, even in Australia it didn't get much reception. But in US, it became a textbook in many libraries now across the native communities. But India has never spoken about them. And since we are hosting the literature festival and calling it Native Chiefs Run nowadays, and I have no idea about this. I was busy in my software world and everything till I exited out of everything in 2017 and focused on what I'm doing now and writing books. I had no idea the division within the US. So what division, when Trump says USA is a Christian country, the first answer comes from Native Americans. And that is the strength of Democrats also, because they don't understand how can this country be called Christian, because when it is a colony of Anglo-Saxons. So how do you see this? Because this is a fact I never see in Indian media and no one discusses it at all.
See, India doesn't intervene very much as far as others are concerned. You'll never find India commenting. except when someone passes a comment on us. It's an internal matter. It's for you all to handle. And when someone comments in India, we hit back. And like Jai Shankar had once very clearly said, I mean, the Ukraine war is a European problem, not ours. But Europe thinks that anything that is a problem for Europe is a problem for the world. Sorry, it needs to wake up. Similarly, anytime US has pointed anything to us, it's hit back. You look at yourself inside. So it is something which is there, but the Indian government doesn't get involved in issues which concern others. We prefer maintaining our own. You will never find us commenting either on the internal affairs of China or any other nation.
But others do that. Others do on Indian internal affairs.
That is what is the Western perception, because they've been used to colonialism and they think it still continues. But when they get a rebuke back, in fact, if you realize during the elections, Germany and the US tried to question Kejriwal's detention. India hit back. Everything stopped. And when the election results came out, there was nothing like a victory period. But it cleared the concept that you know, the whole thing is not the way you looked at it. And such a clear example of democracy couldn't have been the way it came out in the Indian elections.
True.
When you had two people who are in jail for terrorism, even winning seats, what better example have you got of a democracy than you got this?
True. But you know, doesn't it like you know, with our and just like their private media comments on it, we can also comment on it, and we can.
Private media, there are a few pieces that come out.
I'm talking about us, Indian Americans. I can say we can comment.
See, y'all can. Y'all have the right to.
Because it's an internal issue for us. Because we can comment on it, and sometimes. Correct. These indigenous communities, tribal communities, native communities, they seek recognition from countries like India. One of the chiefs told me, include us in the global south because we are a separate entity. And there is a second US constitution, is called Ojibwe Tribe Constitution, which was given as part of the 1783 tribal rights, and which has its own constitution. They have their own president. There are two presidents of the United States. One is the elected Anglo-Saxon president, another is a native president. So these are the two, but these facts are never told, and I was shocked also. And the second president is a very poor president. He doesn't even have a car, but he's the president. So these are the global issues, which I think somewhere these things have to come in. Because the US media usually reports on conflict areas a lot. Or creating conflict areas. Now, my question to you, another question to you is that regarding Pakistan. So Pakistan, we all know, is a sworn enemy, I mean, from their side of India. And they do everything possible to disrupt growth of India. A lot of killings have happened in Kashmir. You commented on Twitter a lot. And so what is your view on what's going on?
See, basically, terrorism will move in an area where the security element is reduced. These are incidents that will happen, which will need to be curtailed, and they will come about. It's something you've got to realize, that the security forces can launch a collection of operations, kill a number of terrorists, it will barely be a four-line issue. One terrorist operation will be headlines for days. So, that is the sort of thing which happens. But the fact is that these incidents are happening. They move generally out of Kashmir to the lower region because the deployment of troops here has been lower. And where the density is low, that is where it will come. And these are incidents that are taking place and will take some time before they again are curtailed, because you've got a few groups inside which need to be eliminated. There is one encounter which is going on currently. So in case with that, you'll have a second group of terrorists getting eliminated. So these things are in process and they will start ending up soon.
You are a man of few words. I think you stick to what you say. And I like that, actually. So thank you, Major General Kakar, for coming on the show today. And this show will be telecast very shortly. And for viewers also, do comment on it. It's a recorded podcast, so people can comment on it. And I'll try to reply. Thank you, and Jai Hind.
Thank you. A total pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.